To tie into it a little bit, they're saying that 64% of millennials have regrets about buying their current home. And, you know, once you actually look at the article, it's not really 64%. It's like 14% regret this part, 10% regret that part. You know what I mean? Like, it's just different little areas of this process. But what pretty much what the article is saying is, like, right now, buying a home is become like a leap of faith. People are buying houses sight unseen. They're bidding on houses that they're not even quite sure. They haven't taken the time. They're waiving inspections. They're waiving appraisals. They're waiving all these things. They're waiving option periods. So a lot of people, and, you know, they think like that's the hardest part. It's like once the high of actually buying the house wears off, they're like, then they start looking at the house. And they start realizing, like, there was a small percentage of people, about, like, I think it was, like, 14%, regretted where the house was located. Like, that's, that you can't change that. you know what I mean? Like, that is not something that you can just say, you know, it's not like, hey, you know, I really regret, I don't know, the color of this kitchen or some. No, it's like you're regretting location of the home.
I know when I bought my first house in 2013 that I lived in, and where I worked, it was like, that was one of the things, like, I wanted easy access to a highway from where I worked out in Bernie, because I was commuting 15-20 miles outside of the city, to where it's like, I want to make sure it's easy access to it, to that road, because I don't want to sit in traffic forever. I don't want to sit there, waste 30 minutes of my day just trying to make it to a highway. And I think that's a huge aspect about housing that people don't take into account when they're driving to house to house to house to house to house to house. They don't, and right now it's like they don't have the time to say, I like this house. Let me see what it's like during traffic hours. What's during, like, during rush hour? How is it to get to a grocery store during certain times of day that I want to get to? You don't have that. It's like you have to jump and just buy it and be like, well, I have to take what I can get because that's it. Yeah. Or you really have to focus on a specific area and then have to see, like, all right, I really want this area because of its location. I like that location. Where do I buy now? Or what do I buy? And it's like, I just got to buy whatever I can get. Or you're sitting there just waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting. Right. And then that fear of missing out, watching prices rise and rise and rise and worrying about getting bid out, to where it's like, yeah, it's a very, very difficult time to be a retail home buyer today.
And then in the article, they also said, among all homeowners, including millennials, the most common regret is underestimating how much the maintenance expenses and other hidden costs associated with buying and owning a home are. And this says roughly about 21% of millennials regretted that. And that is something, like, when people say, you know, I've always had the argument because people always ask me, why do I rent versus own? And, like, I tell them, like, you don't understand what it is to own a home. Like, owning a home, because they look at it very basically, like, you have your mortgage, you're building equity, you're paying it down. It's a good investment, right? It's like, first of all, it's not an investment until I actually sell and realize that actual growth that I've had in the house. And then even then, is the house updated enough or in the conditions to warrant that equity that's been built up based on the neighborhood, right? So it's more money you got to put in. For homeowners, sometimes that is a lot more money than we would spend because we have the contractors, we know the materials, we know the process, we know exactly what to put in a home to keep the cost as low as we can, right? So they don't understand the process that's like actually owning a home, things happen to it, right? Your water heater breaks, your AC goes out, you need this maintenance, you need that maintenance. Next thing you know, you're like, holy crap, anything that goes wrong, especially right now, it's like it's costing me probably like $500, $1,000 to fix.
Yeah.
You know, because most homeowners, what do they got to do? They got to call somebody. Who are they going to call? Not the Ghostbusters, but they're going to call, you know, they're going to go on Google.
Where do I go? They go to Angie's List. They go to those types of investors that do cost significantly more to where, like, hey, I can get a new AC. Yeah, I can get a new AC stalled for, depending on the size, anywhere from $4,000 to $6,000 to where, hey, you go to some other places and it could get a little warm there?
No, I'm so anxious to drink it.
They're going to pay $10,000, $12,000 of roofs. I mean, my God, you pay like $10,000-$12,000 for a new roof that's like, I can get the whole same roof done for $4,500. Like when it comes to insurance aspects of it. So you see those kind of
even what we've seen personally is when people have had their foundations fixed, right?
Oh, God.
And they're like, yeah, well, I already got my foundation fixed and it, you know, and they paid $35,000 for it. I was like, oh, And they like, I put 35 grand. I'm like, I get you paid 35 grand for it, but I would have paid eight. You know what I mean? Like, and the same, I had this one seller that he says, I just put these brand new windows in. They cost me $9,500. And I was like, they cost me like 14. I was like, I'm sorry. Like, I'm not going to pay you more just because, you know, you overpaid well, because you hired a Google contractor.
I've had conversations with people, you know? Like, what is I was talking with somebody and they'd put an offer on a house and the appraisal was way off from what it came. He's like, yeah, I just don't think they took into effect that they put new doors and windows in the house and they just done the foundations. Like, none of that matters to the to an appraiser. Like, it's the fact that I remember having the conversations like, so you're telling me I could have plywood siding on a house next to someone with nice brick stucco, something like that, and those houses could be of equal value. He goes, exactly. Unless you can prove a actual difference in the homes where it's like, hey, this house over here had plywood, and the only thing different was the plywood siding, or just let's call it the T111, the cheapest stuff you can find as far as siding, and the house next door had this, and they are exactly the same, and this one sold less, and it was the only difference, and I can find that difference across the neighborhood saying, like, it is definitely the siding that is causing that, then I can discount the property for that, the windows, the roof, anything like that. So those don't take into account. They have very, very, that basically you have a condition aspect that you can adjust on an appraisal. Yeah. And the condition has to involve the condition of the home, not saying, oh, because you have new windows, we're going to give extra value for those windows. No, it's like, we can give you a condition adjustment, but just because you have new windows and the other house doesn't warrant a house condition being improved on a grand scale.
And as you know, I have new neighbors, and we were trying to actually buy that house before the new neighbors moved in, because the house was in really bad conditions. It had major foundation issues. It needed to be updated. It needed work. It needed to be bought by an investor. So the owner of the house decided to leave it as a wedding gift to his daughter. And I was like, man, you hate your daughter. And they're fixing up the house, and I've told them that you got to start with the foundation. I mean, I can throw out every cliche out there about a strong foundation, but let's bypass all the cliches. You got to fix your foundation, because everything above it just is not going to matter. They obviously can't. They can't afford the foundation repair, right? So they've been fixing the rest of the house, everything. They've had plumbing issues like two or three times already. And I'm like, you're going to continue to have plumbing issues. The house is not supported properly. The water, the way the whole street goes, like all the water from my neighbor's house, my house, everything dumps on their house. So I'm like, you're having, every time when it rains, like you're having all the water just sit on your foundation, like around your foundation, everything. And like, you need to put like either guttering, and I'm telling them all these things, and they're just, it's one problem after another they keep having. They're like, man, yeah,
especially the way your roof pitches, and it's only like 10 everything. Feet to the next house. So it's like, it's just right there, and there's a fence. There's no grass. There's no tree. There's a tree that covers it, so you couldn't grow grass.
No,
and it's just a stop.
It's just a nice little freaking waterfall right into their foundation. And you know, they're like, this house has just become such a money pit. And I was like, but that's the thing. It's like, that's what people don't understand about home ownership. People think, oh, it's an investment. It's something that I'm going to build equity. I'm going to have forever, blah, blah, blah. No.
Well, I mean,
like, and then I'm not saying don't own a home by all means. What I'm saying is, like, you got to factor all these things in. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not just I qualify for a house, so let me buy a house.
No, I agree. I mean, and then people start with the wrong side, because yes, the foundation is the most expensive thing. Well, I can't afford to fix that. I was like, well, then you can't afford the house because it's gonna eat you alive down the road. As far as like, so, and then given. They were gifted the house, they could sell to an investor, and with price appreciation, they might actually do all right in the investment. But it's like, that's a pure gamble that is just like,
well, God, the thing is like, the more money they're putting in, the more they're losing, because all that money, like I told them, they were doing new floors, texturing inside, painting, all this. I was like, as an investor, I'm going to come in and be like, yay, good job, but I got to rip up all the floors because I got to fix the foundation.
Yeah.
Fixing the foundation, I'm going to crack all the walls.
Well, the thing is, we fixed the house that you live in now. Yeah. Like, we fixed that one up, and it's right next door. And we had to lift the entire house, and we had to basically redo all the plumbing. We had a void underneath that house. I remember that, like, you can almost stand up in how deep it was because of the way the streets were and how we had to gut it out underneath there with dirt just for the fact that it's like we had to get to the plumbing. And it ran from all over parts of the house. to fix it. So it's like, yeah, all the flooring is trash. And just like the house that we're doing right now, that we bought it, and the seller less than a year ago fixed all the plumbing underneath the house. Redid all the plumbing. And now it's like, we got to go back and redo all the plumbing, because the entire house had 47 piers, and we had to lift from, I think it's 6 inches from the back of the house to the front. And all the freaking plumbing was on the back side of the house. So it ripped all of that stuff. And when we lifted it, and now it's like, well, now you gain no value in the house by spending $5,000 fixing all the plumbing, because I just spent 15 lifting the foundation. And now I got to go back and spend another $5,000 fix all the plumbing underneath again.
Yeah.
And it's like, you spend it the wrong
place. And you don't get extra value for fixing the plumbing. It's just like, well, you're supposed to have a house with working plumbing. So you're not going to get extra value for that.
Well, it's also one of the things that I think people look at, that it's like, well, I'll afford the foundation later, so I'll fix this. I can afford to fix these things now. It's like, no, you should be saving up to fix the foundation first before you go texturing, painting, putting new cabinets, kitchens. Because like, people don't understand like how jacked up a foundation can really be, especially if you don't understand. Like, I get it if you kind of like us and say, hey, I know I'm going to need to fix that corner of the house over there eventually. Like Grant Tilly.
Yep.
You know what? I don't need to spend the money to fix that now, because I can fix all this stuff and it's no big deal. Yep. Because it's in two opposite corners of the house where there's no plumbing. It's not that big a deal. It's not going to mess with anything too much.
It was such a small deviation. It wasn't 6 inches like we've had on other ones. Yeah, and then also, like, I mean, a big thing to take in mind is that we've had some people criticize the way that we buy our rentals, because we buy houses that are at pretty much flip numbers, because we do this level of rehab to keep as a rental. And people say, oh, you don't know how to invest in rentals. Like, I beg to differ, because again, the amount of money you're going to spend on maintenance, because you're not fixing these things, are going to kill any and all cash flow you're going to have. Plus, you're going to piss off any tenants you have in there, because with all these problems. Like, if you're going to keep a house long-term, whether it's homestead or a rental property, you have to make sure the major components are fixed. You got to make sure they're working. That's why do we keep the majority of the houses that we do a massive renovation in? Because it's like, we know we just did everything new. We did foundation, we did plumbing, we did roof, we did everything. That's like, our risk factor goes way down now. So,
well, I mean, not just that too. It's like, well, and it's kind of fun to now start. Now we're getting to kind of a scale in rental housing on the number of properties we own and manage, that it's like, you can start playing with these numbers. Like, all right, if I ignore these repairs, how does my tenant respond? Do they move out? Do they stay? And it's like, our turnover has been significantly low. And even though we're raising rents on pretty much all of our tenants that are coming to renewals, but it's because we do provide. It's like, hey, you have a problem, you let me know. I get somebody out right away. So it's like, I look at that, especially because I rent too. And it's like, if somebody takes longer to get something there, if like, man, if you really don't give a shit about this, then I don't give a shit about this either. And I was like, so that deferred maintenance, that leak, that problem you're hearing about, not that worried about it. You can figure that out later when I move out. So it's like, you let them, give them the ability to think it's like kind of like their own home.